Today we have a couple of lessons. One of them, the first one read, is the one that's on our journey to the Passion and to the Resurrection. And then the other one is in honor of St. Mary of Egypt. We'll be right there on our wall. This is the Sunday of St. Mary of Egypt. On Thursday night, we did the great canon of St. Andrew. We read the life of St. Mary. You may know it very well, but stories should be retold. St. Mary did not grow up a saint, assuming she was born a Christian, but she chose a different way. She chose the life of a prostitute, willingly, not out of need for money or anything like that. And it tells a story about how she just on a lark decided to go to the Holy Land to venerate the cross. When I say on a lark, it was just so she could have a little fun and cause no trouble. But when she got there, she was forced by her conscience and by the will of God to repent of her former way of life. And she offered herself completely, as we all should, to Christ in exchange for his mercy. And she spent the remainder of her life, when she was a young woman, in the desert, harsh desert on the other side of the Jordan. And God blessed her throughout that time, transformed her into a living icon of his glory and of his grace. And towards the end of, we find out, her life, there was a saintly man named Zosimus who had spent his life trying to become perfect through the church. And he had embraced every kind of ascetic discipline he could find, trying again and again to convert his soul to Christ through all these different struggles. And he kind of despaired that he had come to the end of teachers, but had not come to the end of his own need for grace. And so the Lord led him into that same desert, and he met her. And he learned of grace and how it could transform this woman from a sinner into a saint. And that story is shared with us so that we can learn that same lesson. Not everyone gets it. That's why we need to hear it again. The reading for the gospel contrasts pride with humility. And it shows how pride, this automatic egoism, keeps us not only from repentance, because we don't think we have any need to repent, but it also keeps us from learning. Because what do we have to learn? When it comes to repentance, look at the life of St. Mary. Look at the life of the sinner described in the gospel. What did she do when confronted with the glory of God? She went to where he was and cried over his feet, took the best that she had and offered it to him to glorify him. This anointing with oil is a very powerful symbol for the Jews. Okay? The Christ, the Messiah, is the one who is anointed with oil. Okay? When you are anointed with oil at chrismation, you become little Christ. He took that oil. She took that oil. Love and repentance and all offered it to the Lord. So when confronted with the glory of God, she repented. When confronted with the glory of God, St. Mary repented. What about this Pharisee? What did he do? Well, he invited the Lord over for dinner, but showed precious little hospitality. That's not how you treat people. When you invite people to your home, you invite them to your home, you offer the best that you have. Not just so you can say, the Lord was in my home, George Washington slept here. Well, your life has changed when you encounter the Lord. Unless you are blinded by your pride, unless that pride comes between you and genuine repentance. It also affects our ability to love. not serving well. We are stagnant, and our love is growing cold. And by this, I don't want you to turn into academics. Academic knowledge is probably among the least useful knowledge when it comes to studying the church, studying the Orthodox. The way to study it is to immerse ourselves in her services and in her service, almsgiving, offering ourselves to the poor, as a community and as individuals. These are things that we don't really do much. And I think as a result, our love grows cold. I think the Lord challenges us to a higher standard. But we're satisfied with where we are, with how much we know, and how much we serve, and how much we love. Our love grows cold. Our marriage grows cold. God is not glorified. This is the way it was with the Pharisee. Now the Pharisees, you see, these were tremendous examples of piety. They were the ones who tried to figure out new ways to obey the law, and then tried to impose them on others as well. But his love had grown cold. He could not learn from the Lord who was there before him. When Jesus Christ is in your midst, and Jesus Christ shows you how to serve a woman who is a sinner, you don't argue with her. You say, oh, is that what I'm supposed to do when a sinner comes into my midst? Is that how I'm supposed to behave? You don't say, what are you doing, Lord? What are you doing, Holy Church? Why are you acting that way? Don't you know who that is? We learn. But we can't do it if we think we already know everything there is to know about service and about love. Christ is in our midst. Let's take advantage of that fact. Let's learn more about one another. Let's learn more about how we can serve the needs of the people in our midst. Let's not let our love for one another grow cold. Let's not be satisfied with the fact that we're all friends. Our intimacy should grow as we grow in Christ. How can I serve you more? It should always be the question of our lips. I've been with y'all for a while, and I serve as confessors for people outside of us. And one of the things that I've learned is that everyone is broken. Everyone. There is not a person that I have come to know that is not broken by something that has happened to them or to those dear to them. Don't you want to know how to help someone heal? Don't you want to learn how to bring the grace of Christ into their life? The Lord tells us to love one another, to love even our enemies. The way is open to us. The way to bring healing to every problem, every kind of brokenness. And our intention is not enough. It's not enough to walk to hell. I wish I could do something for someone in the doing enough to study our neighbor so we can learn how to sacrifice worship. These are things that the Lord expects from us.
Mercy. Lord, have mercy. Always now and ever into ages of ages. May the Lord God remember his kingdom. Thank you. Oh. mind at first. I believe also that this is true of your most pure body, and that this is true of your precious blood. Therefore, I pray to you, have mercy on me, and forgive my transgressions, both voluntary and involuntary, of word and deed, committed in knowledge and in ignorance, and make me worthy to partake without condemnation of your most pure mysteries for the remission of sins for life eternal. Amen. Of your mystical supper, Son of God, receive me today as communion. I will not speak of your mystery to your enemies. Only like Judas will I give you a kiss. Like the thief will I confess to you. Remember me, Lord, in your kingdom. May the communion of your holy mysteries, Lord, be neither to my judgment nor condemnation, but to the healing of soul and body. Amen.
Having beheld the resurrection of Christ, let us worship the Holy Lord Jesus, the only sinless one. We venerate the cross, O Christ, and we praise and glorify your holy resurrection. You are our God. We know no other than you, and we call upon your holy name. Come, all you faithful, let us venerate the holy resurrection of Christ. For behold, through the cross, joy has come to all the world. Ever blessing the Lord, let us praise his resurrection. For enduring the cross for us, he destroyed death by death. Shine, shine, O New Jerusalem, for the glory of the Lord has shone on you. Exalt now and be glad, O Zion, and rejoice.